Yes, thank you all for promptly returning after lunch. This panel again starts to look at questions of explainability and algorithms. Can you not? I think I'm not tall enough. Because I think it's on. Sorry, very short. So this panel looks at questions of explainability and algorithms within the context of media, which is not only a really interesting discussion because of debates that are going on about fake news and these sort of buzzwords and things within the news, but also because of the automation that's going on within media right now. And we have really interesting, wonderful panelists who represent a variety of academic, technical, social science, practitioner backgrounds, so it's sort of wonderful to get this diversity of opinions. We will be starting with Gilad Lotan from BuzzFeed, who I invite to come and speak. He has a perspective that primarily comes from some of his startups and all of this wonderful research and beautiful visualizations that represent a lot of these issues for us.
Thanks, Madelyn. Let's see if this works. Perfect. Can you guys hear me okay? Yeah, okay. Hey, I'm Gilad. I lead the data science team at BuzzFeed. You must have heard of BuzzFeed. So we're a media company, news and entertainment, focused, based in New York, LA, and offices all over the world. And really, we serve this massive distributed audience. And we think of ourselves as sort of our with the main goal of producing meaningful content that serves an audience, and different audiences, obviously. So from making people laugh, entertaining them, to informing them, to connecting, right? People use our content to connect with one another, to make stuff, to cook recipes, right? And we really, really consider the effect that our content has on people and specific audiences around the world and on different platforms. We don't care where our audience lives. They can come to our site, they can use our apps, but they can also consume our content on Snapchat and on YouTube. And so we have a massive presence, a distributed presence, all over different platforms. And we're very sort of aware of what's happening across different platforms, from sort of different interactions that people take on our content, so we're consuming and ingesting all that data, to what interests audiences, what topics are working, what videos are actually striking resonance, et cetera. And so our audience inhabits this complex, polluted information environment, right? I think we all agree that it's really hard to make sense of what's going on, right? Whether you search Google, whether you're on Facebook, whether you look at trending topics on Twitter, like, where did this come from? Why is it here? What should I trust, right? And part of our role, especially now, is to help our audience navigate this information space. This is a visualization of a little hack I did a while back where I bought Twitter followers for $5. And I doubled my following that way, which was amazing. And everyone started looking at my profile and thinking I am someone important if I have so many followers. This is how the data looked like, right? It was very clear the organic, real kind of followers versus the fake ones, right? There's connectivity. People have kind of names that are somewhat recognizable. There's a network there versus the fake accounts. But on the surface, when you looked at my account, it was a number that was believable. And what was amazing for me was to realize the real effect this just the simple action had of buying fake followers to my account. One, I noticed an increase, a measurable increase in the acceleration, so the number of people who started following me. But also started to notice these algorithmic consequences. So the fact that Twitter's recommender system takes number of followers into account, number of unfiltered followers, even though they could easily filter out real. They take that number because, I don't know why, it's easy, it's there. Also, other systems look at this number. Like at that time, Bing, the search engine, was integrating all the social data and was using it to rank content when people were searching. So again, there are all these sort of second order effects just from taking this simple action. And so a lot of my work over the past few years has been in this sort of this border between manipulation and optimization. And what is, like, we could call social media optimization, right? Figuring out the right actions to take in order to get your message across in social networks as an act of optimization, right? I'll buy some followers so I make my account more visible so that the people who care about me will actually find me, right? I'll appear higher on search, or I'll sort of use a certain headline to drive, you know, some traffic to an article. Even if it's a little misleading, I'll sort of optimize that article a bit more. But when do we call it optimization and when do we call it manipulation? I think is a really interesting question. And I think, like, a lot of the focus has been on fake, and I know, like, it's been discussed here before, but there is a problem. False information is a problem which lots of folks are working on. But actually, the more interesting and more important thing for us to tackle, I think, is really the sense of propaganda and agenda setting, right? It's not necessarily putting out fake information, but not necessarily releasing the whole story or pointing people in a very specific narrative, right, with a very set agenda, right? So I want to talk about two sort of examples of things in my world that I've worked on using data to sort of try to understand and then pose some questions. So first, let's look at algorithmic system optimization or manipulation. The first example is from so many years ago, it's hard to remember, but Occupy Wall Street, that thing that happened a while back that everyone thought would change the world. It was a really interesting use case, sort of looking at the data, and especially looking at social media, because it was one of the first times that, at least here, folks were massively organizing around an idea and using social media for that. And a lot of it were hashtags. Right, so Occupy Wall Street. Everyone used the hashtag OWS Occupy Wall Street to sort of pass information around, to figure out where to go, where to meet up, where to protest. Right, it was an organizing mechanism, but something happened where, as sort of the movement grew, it started to folks started questioning the legitimacy of some of these online spaces, like Twitter's trending topic algorithm, where Occupy Wall Street never trended. And it felt like while everyone was talking about Occupy Wall Street within networks, it actually never got to that top place, right? And folks were blaming that Twitter was censoring, right? And when you actually looked at the data back then, it was very clear that what you see here is Occupy Wall Street in dark blue. These diurnal patterns, right? Folks tweeting with a hashtag and sort of growing over time, right? It's a movement that started in physical space and organized online, but there was sort of momentum had built up over weeks and months, where other hashtags that were trending, stuff like hashtag I can respect you if, or Kim Kardashian's wedding, or at the same time, thank you, Steve, right? Steve Jobs had just died. Those had all trended. And when we look at the data, it's very clear what kind of event this algorithm is promoting, right? All these other events that had trended were very spiky in nature, right? And they were terms that were new or the system had not seen in the past, you know, X amount of time. Whereas Occupy Wall Street was something that, even though the term itself was quite new to the system, it never, at least initially, generated this significant spike. Hence, it never reached trending topics. And the reason why you want to reach trending topics, especially as an event organizer, is for visibility, right? You just gain so much more visibility from getting to that list, right? So there's true power in this algorithmic system that makes very specific decisions on what is important and what is not, that were not necessarily designed for by the engineering team behind this. A more recent example was from the first presidential debate, where Donald Trump and his supporters, the morning after, were pointing to this hashtag that was trending everywhere. This Trump won, right? And they were pointing to it as proof that he had won the debate, right? And there are all these people blaming Russia for sort of seeding the hashtag and pushing it, or Ukrainian sources and for bots to be behind it. But actually, when you looked at the data, you could see that the sort of trends over time, there was this highly organized network that was sort of activated on this hashtag. They organized online, chose the right keyword, and sort of all used it at the same time from different parts of the world. So when you looked at the trend map, you could see that this trend kind of, this hashtag started trending in across different US cities and around the world, and accelerated really fast. And a lot of these accounts were not bots. They were real people. They were just organized, right? And they sort of knew how to manipulate this algorithmic system. Another example I want to talk about is polarization, right? And something we're seeing more and more of, especially within social network spaces. So as an Israeli, I've been tracking politics there for a while. And in a way, it's interesting to see where we're at now here politically, because it kind of feels like deja vu for me. But when I look at specific examples, like in the last war that between the IDF and Hamas, throughout different events, it was very clear that there was like just incredible polarization. It was hard to talk about any issue in substance, because just the information was so different depending on what camp you're on. So in this one case, there was a shooting that happened. The IDF targeted a UN school, right? And these events happened throughout the war, like every hour there was some other event, right? But just looking at this one specific event and the reactions to the event, on one hand, you saw coverage. So this is something that happened, right? There's no question that the missile hit the school, right? Nobody's questioning that. But the way the story was framed on one side was very, very different from the way it was framed on the other side. On one hand, the focus was on the fact that Hamas activists were in the school and were shooting from the school. So the army targeted the school. And the other was focused on on all the civilians who died. Both were true. Both pieces of information were true, but framed a completely different story and narrative. And actually, when you mapped out the landscape of people who were mentioning, responding, talking about the event and passing information around, this shape is what came out, and this was consistent across these similar events that happened throughout the war. You get sort of one narrative on one side being passed around and another on the other side, and your network position really really affects the kind of information you're likely to see, because it represents the people you follow, right? And so if you're placed in one cluster of users, you're much more likely to see a very specific frame. And what was interesting in this case was to identify a point or a sort of node in this network with the highest between a centrality, which was a relatively sort of left-wing Israeli media outlet called Haaretz that had the highest potential or probability to sort of bridge across sides, because it had more links to both sides of who were sending out different narratives. And so why is this happening? Why do we see this polarization? And this is something like, this is just one very specific event and one news story, but this, think of this happening continuously, right? Throughout the day, during this war, but also with almost every sort of politicized event that is covered. And so on the one hand, we have homophily, right, which is a well-studied phenomenon by social scientists, where birds of a feather flock together. We like to sort of be near people like us, and we do it in the physical world and also online, right? We hang out with people who are like us. It's comfortable. Another are all these algorithmic systems that rank content, and specifically something like collaborative filtering, which may recommend we follow someone based on aggregate behavior. So if I follow George W. Bush and The Blaze on Facebook, I'll get Fox News as a recommendation, right? Try it out. Follow a politician and on Facebook, and you'll see recommendations for very similar politicians. And so we're seeing, I'm going to jump because I'm running out of time, but these dynamics, so algorithmic ranking system, homophily, feed these sort of increasingly polarized spaces. And we're seeing this, these same patterns over and over again. So in this case, this is sort of coverage out of San Bernardino a few years ago. And again, we're seeing very different headlines, very different stories that make the front page depending on which sort of area of the network you're in. And as you can tell, the focus of the story is just is completely different. And so in a world of alternative realities, right, as we're constructing these algorithmic systems that effectively push us towards one side of the bubble to another, how do we think about these different realities, effectively personalized propaganda spaces that we're building, we're all constructing? And how do we think about informing and building systems that help folks understand where they're at within these networks, but also the kind of manipulation that happens? This is tracking before the elections, communities of sort of Donald Trump supporters who are passing around these sort of these polls who are predicting Trump would win, and this was their reality. And this was consistently, as I was tracking these groups, this is what they truly believed in, and this is the kind of information they passed. And so, but this is not only Facebook, it's not only false information, like these systems are everywhere, right? And I think a lot of times the focus is on Facebook, they're getting a lot of heat for it because it's perhaps a lot more visible or easy to surface on Facebook. But there are issues with Google, there are issues on YouTube, they're effectively everywhere. Just try to search for Hillary's health, right, and see what you get on the top top results. So as we think about manipulation and network propaganda, I think one interesting way to look at this is to understand context by someone's network position, right? So how do we better understand a network, the structure and someone's position in order to make informed decisions? We're definitely investing in understanding algorithmic manipulation and bias, and I think it's partly our, like media outlets, it's our duty to run investigations and to effectively serve as the watchdog to understand where there is bias, which systems are biased, maybe for certain geographic locations, and then help our audience make sense of these complex media ecosystems. One way we're trying out one thing, which we launched recently, is this sort of module that appears on BuzzFeed News, which brings responses from different perspectives around a story that is important, a daily story. Right, so we're trying to inform our readers and say, well, here's how we covered this, but here's how other people are looking at this. But this is obviously one solution in a place which has many, many problems. So thank you, Gilad, and looking forward to your questions. We're gonna go.
Diakopoulos, who is a professor of journalism at the University of Maryland and offers a perspective on algorithmic and computational journalism issues.
So, how do we change the input on this?
Great. All right. Thanks so much for the introduction. So yeah, I'm Nick Diakopoulos from the University of Maryland. I've been working at this sort of intersection of computation and journalism for several years now, and thinking a lot about algorithmic accountability, how we can actually explain the bias, the power, the influence of algorithms in society. Today, I'm going to tell you a little bit about my work, specifically about algorithmic transparency. So looking at how we can think about disclosure of information about algorithms in use in society, but actually I'll focus more specifically about the algorithms in use in the media. So sort of by way of motivation, algorithms are pervading our media system now. So we have folks like the AP building automated translation systems that can convert a story written for one context or genre into another. We have outlets like the Washington Post building news bots to engage with users about events like the Olympics or the elections last year. We have outlets like Reuters building complex clustering systems that suck in all of the social media content that they're observing and try to detect breaking news events, try to detect eyewitnesses, and then alert reporters to those things. We have outlets like Buzzfeed News using simulation and modeling in investigative journalism, in this case, to try to detect potential fraud in professional tennis. And of course, we have the real-time anxiety meter that the New York Times published during the election last year. Clearly, very data-driven, a lot of modeling going on there to convey information. So given that algorithms are sort of everywhere within the media now, the question comes up, well, how does the media hold itself accountable? Particularly, the media is kind of an interesting case because we sort of have a little bit of an aversion to regulating free speech in this country. And so we sort of look to the media to police itself in order that we don't overregulate it. And one of the ways that the media attempts to do that is through sort of normative pressure and adhering to things like transparency. So transparency has actually been studied in journalism for a number of years. There are sort of good definitions out there. This is a definition that I like from a professor at Amsterdam. He says, transparency is defined as, quote, the ways in which people both inside and external to journalism are given a chance to monitor, check, criticize, and even intervene in the journalistic process. So that's sort of the traditional notion of transparency within journalism. The question for us here today, I think, is how can we be transparent about algorithmic systems? And to try to get toward what that means, what algorithmic transparency means, I convened a workshop, it was about 2 years ago now, at Columbia University Tao Center for Digital Journalism. We had about 50 people come in. From the media industry, also from sort of information science and journalism, and pick apart three case studies and do focus groups around these case studies. So including things like automated news content, that's algorithms that write financial news or sports news based on structured data. Next case study was algorithmic curation, so certainly things like news feeds, but also including systems in place for, say, moderating discussions or comments on news sites, and also looking at simulation and modeling as a case study, so trying to understand some of these models that were being used to, say, visualize and tell stories on news sites. So we got a lot of people together, we focus grouped each of these case studies, and we wanted to try to ask questions like, well, what could you even make public about these algorithms in these different cases? What are the bits of information that could be disclosed? What are the limits of that algorithmic transparency? Where is their friction? Where is their pushback? What are the mediating factors? And then what would an actual disclosure mechanism look like? So we kind of took those conversations, it was about 500 pages of transcribed audio, and kind of boiled it down into this abstraction of different layers across which we might disclose or be transparent about the algorithm in question. And I'll give you a reference at the end of the presentation if you want to drill into this, but sort of at a high level, we can talk about disclosing information about the data that's used, things like the provenance of the data, the quality of the data, how it was sampled, and so on. We can think about disclosing bits of information about the model itself, things like the features that were used, the feature weightings that were used in the model. We could disclose bits of information about the inference, like its accuracy, its error rate, the types of uncertainties that are inherent to it. And we can also look at the interface as a layer through which transparency is communicated, including things like interactivity with the model. Off to the side here, you kind of see this loving embrace of human involvement across all of these layers. And really what we found over and over again in these conversations is that kind of this emphasis on the people that are involved and that are present in all of these layers, which really, I think, complicates this notion of transparency, because we do have human decisions, human design, human intervention happening across these systems. There were also a number of business concerns that came up, over the course of these focus groups. So, where is there friction? Certainly the costs of producing this information, I think that's something that we need to have a serious consideration of. If we actually want to implement algorithmic transparency, we have to be able to make a case to businesses that that's something that they can afford. So looking at things like data, the cost of data preparation or the cost of additional document generation or benchmarking on particular data sets, that's all going to take time and effort and money. Should the New York Times, should Google, should Facebook be hiring teams of people to produce this information? There can be privacy issues. That's a concern that came up for some people, particularly if we're getting into investigative journalism and thinking about whether or not we want to disclose the data that we used behind the model that we built. There can be issues there with not wanting to disclose people's identities. There can be legal concerns, right? So if I build a model for my investigative journalism project that predicts that that politician is a douchebag, but my, excuse me, was that a bad word? I'm not sure about that. But okay, let's go with that. But that what if that model is only 80% sure of that politician? Do I, and I publish that? That becomes a legal liability, because if I'm transparent that my model is only 80% sure of that politician, then that kind of opens the door for a legal concern there. So trade secrets and competitive advantage, that was another issue that came up over and over again. This is particularly, I think, an issue for the types of algorithms that are used in more product-oriented types of systems. So compare that to an investigative scenario where a journalist is building a model for some kind of editorial purpose, a story that they're writing. That kind of use of computation tends to be less sensitive to things like trade secrecy, whereas if you are building a product-oriented algorithm, something for recommending news, let's say, there might be more sensitivity to disclosing information about that. And then finally, a big one, manipulation and gaming, right? So concerns over if we disclose too much information about how the system works, people are just going to play with that, and it's going to undermine it. The other major concern that came up over and over again was this idea of cognitive complexity. So if we're going to be transparent about algorithms that we're using in the media, we need to make sure that that information that we're disclosing is accessible and understandable and also fits within whatever decision framework the end user needs to make with that information, right? We don't want to just do an information dump. So we need to explain this transparency information in context, and we need to think about the interfaces and the vehicles for communicating that information. There's a number of really interesting open questions here. This is kind of my text dump slide, but sort of looking forward, what do I think are interesting research questions? Thinking about user studies and user modeling. So trying to understand, if we disclose this particular bit of information, how is that going to change the decision calculus for different stakeholders? How are they going to interact with that and so on? And how could that potentially have an impact on outcomes? The second point, manipulation. I think there's an interesting opening here to think about security and this idea of threat modeling. So, security has this idea of threat modeling where we can kind of think through beforehand, what are the potential security issues here? Well, what are the potential issues around disclosure of a particular piece of information in terms of how that information might be manipulated or circumvented or gamed? Who stands to gain or lose if a particular piece of information is exploited? Can we build up better ways for thinking through that as we design these systems so that we're prepared for certain cases? Cost, as I mentioned, is an important one. I think there definitely needs to be more research from a practical point of view in how much time and money and effort it would take to be truly transparent about certain things. And of course, where you fall on that spectrum of cost is going to depend on what the risk profile of the application is, you know, talking about different domains, credit, health, media, and so on, you might be more or less willing to invest in transparency for different scenarios. And then presentation, you know, I come from a human-computer interaction background, very interested in how information is presented and how people interact with that information. I think there's a lot of interesting research to do looking at how we publish transparency information, how people interact with it, and even things like, you know, how often do you publish transparency information? These systems can be changing on a minute-by-minute basis. You know, Google changes its search algorithm hundreds of times a year. You know, what's the right model for communicating that kind of dynamism? Sort of going back to this presentation question and also the cognitive overload question, I wanted to give you an example of I think, some innovation within journalism that is kind of, it's making some progress on this question of cognitive overload. So some of you might be familiar with this story, actually from BuzzFeed News. I did not coordinate this with Gilad, but it's just a really good example of this idea. The tennis racket. Basically, the reporters on this were digging into and investigating fraud in professional tennis. And what they did is they built a model. They scraped some data looking at betting odds for different tennis matches. And they built a model that could sort of predict or provide some evidence of whether or not a particular player was kind of suspicious looking in terms of whether or not they might have thrown the match intentionally. So this provided some evidence that they then worked into this long narrative. They didn't end up naming names. It was anonymous. But they did kind of suggest a direction that they were going with the story. So in terms of transparency and how they conveyed their use of this model in the story, I wanted to give some examples. So, and they kind of have this hierarchy of information presentation, of algorithmic transparency information presentation for different stakeholders. So at the top level of this presentation, we have, I think, what can only be described as sort of the BuzzFeed-y version of transparency, right? It's kind of these like short digestible nuggets of information about the investigation and what was done, including animated GIFs to just give it that characteristic BuzzFeed style. But then if you were interested, you could actually drill in and see a GitHub page, which presented the methodology that the journalists had used in this story. And it was kind of a somewhat high-level methodology. It described the scraping process. It described you know, the types of questions they were looking at and some of their decisions along the way. And then finally, you could kind of drill in even one step further and look at the code that they used to run their simulation and to build their statistical evidence for their story. So you have these three different layers of information, potentially for different types of stakeholders, and I just wanted to present this as one example of how you might think about algorithmic transparency in the real world. So as a final thought, I just kind of wanted to take a minute to compare transparency and explanation. The way I think about it, transparency is really about the what of an algorithm. It's sort of the substrate or the information that would inform an explanation. Whereas an explanation is really about the how. How is an algorithmic decision made? How did an outcome come about? It's about, you know, we heard about this yesterday, it's about causality. It's about answering the question of why. I think very importantly from our study, we found how ingrained humans were across all of these levels of sort of data model inference and interface. And I think thinking about explaining how humans are embedded in that socio-technical system is incredibly important, including the human intent behind different types of design decisions. And then finally, explanation, I think, is about adapting to different stakeholders, you know, framing information for different types of decision makers and so on. So with that, I will wrap it up and say thank you. And also, you know, just point you toward some related papers that will expand on all the details of this work. Thank you.
Brad Greenberg, who comes from Yale Law's Information Society Group, and he not only represents a legal perspective, but also has a background in journalism.
Thank you, Madelyn. I will start by adding to the fact that I'm here in my role at the Yale ISP. I also work at the U.S. Copyright Office, and nothing I say today should be imparted back to the office as an official or unofficial position. This is what I do in my fun on my own time, strange as that may be. So I'll start by giving you a little background you're probably familiar with, and that is that, say for some of you like Kyle and Amanda who are not on Facebook, Facebook is the place where most people get their news today. It is bigger than CNN, it's bigger than the New York Times. It has an audience that any news outlet would die for, obviously. And this is like a truism at this point. Facebook does not have, though, a human news team. They once did. And they've actually sort of had this roller coaster of their relationship with whether or not they are even a news outlet. They're not, then they are, then they get rid of the human editors. Now they're sort of, there was a great New York Times Magazine piece just in the last couple of days on sort of Mark Zuckerberg's sort of reckoning with, you know, what to do with the burden of being a social agenda setter, of shaping really the world we're living in, because so many people get their news from Facebook. Last fall is actually late last summer is when they got rid of their human news team, and almost immediately the results were both comic and tragic. They started trending stories that, you know, Megyn Kelly had been fired by Fox for supporting Hillary Clinton. This didn't happen. Then they trended a story on 9/11 that claimed that World Trade Center towers was a controlled demolition. This wasn't just a conspiracy theory spreading around, but it actually was on like their trending stories sidebar. And it was, you know, had the imprimatur of being real news. There's plenty of other examples we could go to. You know, if we look at just around the presidential election, there were the Pizzagate claims. This, you know, these things get out there. Once they're there, they just get embedded in readers' consciousnesses, and we, you know, it leads to. I'm sure all you know this, but in D.C. shortly after the election, a guy from North Carolina showed up at Comet Pizza, which is a pizza and ping pong parlor, which had allegedly been or allegedly was the site of a DNC child sex ring. He showed up there with a gun and fired it off. Fortunately, no one was hurt. But, you know, once these things get out, once the gatekeepers aren't really doing any control of the information, people sort of run wild with what they've heard and can't be disproven otherwise of. In fact, actually, there was a study that found in the final months of the November election, viral fake news outperformed that of real news on Facebook. This is unusual as a platform that is a source for such misinformation, hoaxes, conspiracies, but Facebook is far from anomalous in their place as a news entity that is moving more towards automation. It's not just about distribution. That's largely what it is for Facebook and Google News, sites like that. But news organizations are also using automation to decide which stories to cover, to decide how to allocate resources, to actually write stories. Nick just referred to a few different models of that. And so before I get into some of the downsides of this, and this really is, I think, the sort of the pessimistic perspective on this panel about news automation, and then some of the legal implications, professional implications, I do want to get a little bit into just sort of explaining what these different categories of news automation look like. I will first start by saying, though, that this push towards news automation comes amid a very difficult time for news outlets. And when I talk about news organizations, I typically am referring to traditional print and online entities. But it doesn't, I mean, the you know, economics have been bad for news, for TV news, for magazines, it's horrible. And so this stuff sort of does apply in various ways across the news business. But just looking at print, digital revenue is up generally for most outlets, but print is just continues to plummet. Even the New York Times, which for legacy outlets tends to do about as well as you can hope for digital revenue. Their total revenue in quarter three last year was down 8% despite massive online gains. The traditional newsrooms, their staff has fallen from 56,900 in 1990 to 32,000 last July, and circulation has dropped by over, like it's fallen in half. And that's actually at some of the better outlets. Places like USA Today have fallen from, I think, like 1.8 million to like 250,000. That's because I don't think hotels buy them as much, but it's bad. Like, just to say it's bad. So amid this, news organizations have been moving more towards automation. So what does that look like? Well, I think there's sort of three categories. This is, as legal academics like to do, a bit of a taxonomy moment in this talk. But first, we have our automated reporters and AI editors. And I apologize. These terms aren't all technologically perfect, but they're a little cuter for the remembering who's doing what in this process. But so for your automated reporters, this is largely referring to like the signaling tech or social listening tools. I think this is what Reuters is doing. I actually hadn't heard about that project, but there's a few third-party providers of this. One example is called Dataminer, and they scour Twitter for tweets that the algorithm considers to be important. I read a CJR article talking about this, and it says, they quote, spot the one random tweet among millions and predict whether it will be big news. So what this does is if there's a police shooting in suburban St. Louis that the New York Times would not usually hear about until like day four, after it had been covered by, you know, the local press and the St. Louis Post-Dispatch, then, you know, CNN shows up and the New York Times does their toe touch, you know, reporter flies out there, writes a story about it. Now they can know about that 5 minutes after it happens or sooner. It really does flip the model of, you know, the national press coming in to cover the local stuff long after the local has been covering it for days. We also have these AI editors are using algorithms to allocate newsroom resources, things like page design and layout to, you know, maximize eyeballs, and story promotion. This is, I think, actually largely a good area of the use of algorithms in news, but it does still take some of the traditional role of editors in deciding what is newsworthy and what's important and how are we going to promote this away from them. And hand that off to algorithms. Then we have robo-writers. This is, again, Nick mentioned a couple of these, but a pretty good example is the LA Times QuakeBot, which is used to basically write, it's a script that just takes whatever the output is from the U.S. Geological Survey after an earthquake, and within minutes you have an article on latimes.com that tells you how big the earthquake was, what time it happened at, where the epicenter was. It doesn't know things like, were there any casualties, you know, was this necessarily an aftershock or, you know, a first quake or whatever it is, but it sort of has like the bare bones, and then a reporter can follow along and fill in the missing details. There's been a lot of ventures in this direction in terms of sports recaps, financial news, stuff that is sort of pretty formulaic in the way it's written up, and is also doesn't usually need a lot of individual sourcing. You can imagine a lot more in this direction. You know, maybe city councils put out press releases, or they put out their minutes, and a script knows how to break that down to get out a quick story to people about what was voted on last night at the city council meeting. Or weather stories, government reports like unemployment and GDP. These are all things that you can imagine being automated at some point if they aren't already by someone. And then finally, we have algorithmic delivery, which is effectively Google News, Facebook, and legacy news media is doing this too. AP News now offers a personalized news feed tailored to preferences and behavior. And I've seen other papers that are basically they give home pages specific to zip codes. So if you go there, if you live in New York, and you go to, well, a better example would be like if you live in suburban Washington, D.C., and you go to the WashingtonPost.com, you might see, you know, the Loudoun County favored homepage, as opposed to if you live in D.C. proper, and you're going to get more D.C. metro news. Now the trouble with this, and it's not all bad, but I'm going to focus on the problems because it's limited time, and I think this is where we can give the most consideration. I don't need to review, I think, for this audience, the big data bias literature. But I'll just say that it does apply in many ways to news automation. Plus, I think there's a few other considerations. So just generally speaking, there are latent biases in using algorithms to do traditional news functions. For news disseminators like Facebook and Google News, consumers are much less likely to be familiar with the outlet they are reading than they are if it's their local newspaper or it's their, you know, it's, you sort of have a perspective that, you know, the New York Post, the New York Daily News have different political leanings. If you read them regularly, you know what those are, but you have no idea what the political leanings are of, you know, sort of an innocuously named online-only site that you've never heard of before, but has some real explosive story that really catches your attention. this is sort of the reality at the heart of the fake news phenomenon, and I was glad Gilad mentioned this, because I'm going to talk a little more about it. I think fake news is a horribly lumped term. I'm really talking about several different things with it. But in general, what we're talking about is the fact that readers, it's crazy to say this, but they aren't necessarily sophisticated enough all the time to recognize that a website like Hustlers.com is not probably a reputable news organization and is a place that is just spreading propaganda. Additionally, these biases are often hidden under the cloak of objective code. Someone referenced yesterday the Chris Anderson article from 2009, but the idea that with enough data, you don't need science, it's just there, like the data speaks for itself. No, it doesn't, right? You need someone to interpret it, but more importantly, you need someone to sort of strip away the underlying biases of it. And finally, algorithms ossify story structure and narrative. So if an algorithm or a script is written to tell all future, I don't have a great example that would sort of reflect maybe like a gender bias or sexuality bias 5 years later, but if a script is written in 2015, it's gonna be telling sort of a stopped in time story from 2015 in 2020 when it's still being used, assuming it isn't updated to fill that same spot. Significantly, and outside of the sort of big data biases literature, I think that automating news misses very important stories. So one example is there are a lot of stories that aren't going to trigger your signaling technology, but once they were written would actually get a lot of shares. I'm thinking of something like LA Times did a 17-part feature 15 years ago called Enrique's Journey. It was a story about like an 8-year-old boy traveling by himself from Central America to get to the United States. It won a Pulitzer Prize, I think both for the feature writing and for the photography. It's a phenomenal work of journalism, but it's hard to see how that story is going to be written if you're just relying on signaling technology. Additionally, automating journalism has this sort of infinite regression problem of trending stories all the way down, or turtles all the way down, right? Who originates the new information if someone's always waiting for the new information to be put out there by someone else? Oh boy. Another problem is that signals may preference some voices that are louder but not necessarily more representative. So during Hurricane Sandy, we had way more tweets from Manhattan about what was going on with Hurricane Sandy than we did from Long Island. Long Island was hit a lot harder than most of Manhattan, right? And so if you're just looking at the signaling technology, you may have a tainted perspective or a skewed perspective on what's actually happening in the real world. I'll just skip ahead a minute here because I'm sort of already running low on time. But the real losers here are costly and time-consuming local and investigative news that has a low audience. And that is really my big concern because I come at this from a democratic self-governance, like news is essential to democratic self-governance perspective, and that's where I really worry. Finally, fake news. Let's split that up a little. So what we're talking about here is at least three things. One is like faux news, so hoaxes, conspiracies. These are the things that Facebook gets fooled on all the time, but legacy media do too, and even when they're not using algorithms, this happens. There was a story 2 years ago or a year and a half ago about El Chapo, the famous Mexican drug lord, that he had sent a threatening letter to ISIS. He was going to basically, you know, unleash the cartel on ISIS, and it was, like, you know, cool, I guess, like, you know, whatever, but the Fox News Latino picked this up, Fortune picked this up. Now you can imagine if you're using an algorithm, it's even more likely to pick up that information where you don't have an editor who's applying their BS radar, especially if that algorithm isn't trained to avoid non-trusted sources. Now you could train it to avoid non-trusted sources. I think that's actually one thing that'd be helpful, but if it's not, you sort of have an even deeper problem. Then there's the fake trends and sort of solidifying flimsy narratives. This is one person's complaining about the new Starbucks cup. Every news outlet then reports on the one person and the reporting of the one person complaining about the Starbucks cup, which becomes outrage think pieces, which then become outrage about the outrage pieces, which then become think pieces about outrage culture. You know, you rinse, spit, repeat, whatever the next thing is. This reminds me, of a law review article that cites to a law review article, cited to a law review article, that cited to a case, cited to a case, cited to a case, and nobody ever goes back and looks at the first case to see, did they interpret this correctly? And you just continue moving forward this poor narrative. Again, this happens with human reporters too, but you're much more likely, if you're not relying on the computer, for somebody to break free of the monotony and go outside that and say, let's step back here and let's do a little, revisionist history and see if we've missed this all along. And then finally, misinformation. This is more what we're talking about, at least part one prong of this. So there's the unintentional, and this, like, around the Boston bombing, there was all kinds of bad information the first day, falsely identified or errantly identified suspects. Around mass shootings, we see this all the time, where the first reports online are basically that there's three shooters in four locations and 22 injured or dead. And then once time has gone on, the numbers sort of shake out. It's, you know, it's one person, it's a lot of confusion, and hopefully the casualties aren't you know, nearly that high, whatever it is. But then there's the intentional, and this is our, you know, around the presidential election, this is the propaganda or the narrative shaping. So sometimes it's state-sponsored trolls, other times it's sort of entrepreneurial. You know, Americans, the New York Times had a great article about a 23-year-old kid from Maryland who spent $5 on the URL Christian Times newspaper and then put out a story that, quote, tens of thousands of ballots pre-marked for Hillary Clinton found in Ohio warehouse. And then it just, the story just takes off and people are like, oh, see, voter fraud's real, all this stuff. And it's hard to sort of get outside that once it's there. I will just say, because I'm really out of time. I think, no, we okay? Okay. So I think, and Frank's heard me talk about this before at his algorithm conference last year, but I think this undermines the profession, right? I think that when journalists sort of punt a lot of their responsibilities to technology, I think sometimes it can be great, but I think other times you run the risk of handing off too many duties. And I think long term, this can have significant both professional and economic business considerations, harms, because long term, I mean, some you know, algorithmic efforts are doing incredible things in journalism. I'm not talking about everything being a pox on the profession, but I do think that there is, to the extent that journalism is in a fight for its soul in terms of, like, preserving goodwill with the public, the less that human editors are actually, and reporters are actually doing, the less argument they have. And then to the extent that I think journalism serves an important democratic function, and I do, I think this is dangerous for democracy. So two last points. So there's two real ways to approach this. One is professional norms. This was mentioned a minute ago. You know, you could sort of have best practices. You could have, you already have very strong existing journalism ethics. There's an in-group and an out-group problem here, right? There's a lot of new entrants to journalism, and they don't all subscribe to the same values. So I think that raises some challenges to things that are basically, to using professional norms as sort of a pressure. Then there's, you know, we have legal solutions. I'm not sure on this, and I definitely don't think it's a silver bullet. I think this is an area where we tread very carefully because we could have a solution that's worse than the problem, or as bad as the problem at least. Nick mentioned transparency. I think that's great, although I'm more concerned, what I'm really concerned with is transparency can help show if there is accuracy and accountability and reasoned decision making, but I don't necessarily think it is either necessary or sufficient for that. I think we could have other regimes that help us find out, or at least hold newspapers and news organizations to the standards that they are accurate and accountable and making reasoned decisions and promoting democratic self-governance through the work they're sharing, even without necessarily having access to the data. So even if we can't confirm it ourselves, we still can, you know, if there is, let's say, Nick, I think you mentioned it. I mean, a newspaper doesn't get off the hook. Defamation law still applies, right? Like, so if they print that some congressman is a douchebag, but there's only an 80% probability, I think under the public figure standard, that sounds like reckless disregard for the truth to me. 80% is not that high a probability. Is 95 high enough? I don't know. And I don't know that courts are going to be very well equipped to deal with that. But there's certainly not a blank check here in using algorithms to do news functions without potential legal liability. There's also some opportunities in consumer protection, possibly, for holding them accountable, you know, for fake news, for clearly fake news. I don't know where, again, the lines are really hard to draw in this area, though. Same thing would go for trade secret, right? You could say that any algorithm that's used to just determine which information, which news articles people see cannot avail itself of trade secret. It cannot be held in. It has to be made public. But then again, where do you draw the line? What is, you know, what is a news outlet, what is news information? You know, those are things that courts have struggled with for decades to really figure out, and I don't know they're going to be good about it here. Finally, I think there's a lot to talk about here in terms of the implications for First Amendment theory, but I think I'll actually hold off on that because we've gotten into a lot. Thank you.
We're happy to take questions.
I mean, I would say that the default is opting in instead of opting out because of money. I mean, if you want to kill the user experience of Facebook, sure, have pop your bubble Thursdays or whatever. I thought it was actually fascinating to read Mark's 6,000-word manifesto a couple months ago, because you could kind of see him start to wake up and perhaps even come to realize that he was a journalist at heart and that he cared a lot about community development and community goals. But there's a big question mark in terms of how that creates a tension with the business side of his organization. And I certainly didn't see that resolved in his manifesto. I guess we'll have to wait to see what happens in the marketplace.
Yeah, I was just going to say it's bad for business. As Facebook is waking up and realizing it actually not dealing with it is bad for their business. So in a way, they are taking all these actions now, more than they've ever taken. And historically, Facebook just was opting to be the pipes, right? They're not a media outlet. They don't make decisions. They just serve information, content, and they serve the space for people to interact. But now they're actually taking concerted steps with the Facebook Journalism Project and just different ways in which they're starting to have these conversations and figure out what they would like to do, right? I think with the outside your bubble stuff, where do we draw the line? How paternalistic, like, do we decide for our audience, say, you know, this is good for you, right? And effectively, that's an editorial decision, right? That's a decision that's made daily, right, in media outlets. With the outside your bubble module, sure, it's getting visibility, but it really depends. I mean, a lot of sort of what becomes visible on a site is dependent on where it's placed and how it's promoted. So the numbers, right, really depend on that. If it's a module that lives on a story, that's sort of at the top of the page versus a B page, and how much it gets promoted. But we think a lot about trust and really, like, doing as a media outlet, figuring out how to best serve our audience while just keeping their trust and helping. I think explainability is a big part or plays a big role here. Saying, you know, we're covering this because, or we're doing this because we think, you know, it's important, or even if we don't have the full information or it's not 100% verified, like the dossier that BuzzFeed published, having a strong stance and explaining why why the information is being published, I think, is increasingly important.
So I want to say more about the idea that Facebook is just sort of there letting everybody chat and talk and share things and doesn't really have any responsibility after that, but I think I'm actually not going to. But I'm a little uncomfortable with that idea, right, that technologists sometimes take that we just give you the technology and you decide what to do with it, because it's built in a way where it has certain uses that are going to be maximized. But I'll stop there on that. But I will say, on the paternalistic point, I skipped that part of my talk. I mean, this is not my politics generally, and I don't write in any other area do I talk about paternalism, but this is an area where I'm just like unabashedly like feed people the broccoli, right? People need, democracy needs certain information. And so Cass Sunstein, you know, has written for years about the architecture of serendipity or serendipity of architecture that newspapers were, because you had to get, you know, if you read the New York Times, I mean, maybe you don't think David Brooks is really a conservative, but, you know, you get David Brooks with, I don't know, Frank Bruni or whoever. I don't actually read op-eds, so maybe I'm not a good person to talk about that. But, you know, more importantly to me is when you get your local paper, you get the city council meeting stories, you get, you know, the investigation into the school board president with your local sports and your lifestyle. Right, and we want people to be paying for both, and it's so much harder in the disaggregated world of online journalism, especially of automated journalism. It's just harder to give them things that they're not already asking for, especially when the main source they're going to is Facebook. Which Farhad Manju, in that New York Times Magazine piece I referred to a minute ago, he said, "This is, I think, a nice quote. Facebook sucks up lies from cable news and Twitter, then precisely targets each lie to the partisan bubble most receptive to it." Like, that can't be a good thing for us long term, right?
But that's not, first of all, that's not the typical case. I mean, sure, it happens, but it happens with Google, with YouTube too, right?
Yeah,
so why,
yes.
Like, why are we so
focused?
I'm not
picking on Facebook. I don't mean to pick on Facebook. That's why I tried to say earlier, they're not like, you know, alone in the wilderness here. I think that everyone's doing it sort of. You know, a lot of news outlets is different in degree more than it is different in kind.
I think we have two specific follow-up questions right over here.
Yeah, well, I'm gonna take a question you passed up on and say, there's first the assertion that what Facebook used to do was just say we are the pipes, and now the assertion that Facebook is somehow is serious about journalism, and I'm gonna call bullshit on both, and say that, they haven't been just, you know, if you have a service that sort of operates in a like chronological order or something like this, that's one thing. But Facebook has very clearly been not just the pipes since they introduced the newsfeed, if not before. It's pretty obvious. Like they have a direct curatorial role. Any assertion that they were just the pipes is sort of like defensive language specifically to sort of shield them. But it's completely disingenuous. And to like give any credibility to that is, I think, a bit ridiculous. And then the assertion that now they are serious about journalism is like saying that large medical systems are across the board really serious about electronic health records, which is no, they're serious from a compliance standpoint. They're under fire and doing minimum possible, it seems, to sort of shield themselves from a PR disaster. And to give them credit prematurely, I think, is also a bit of a mistake. I don't think like overnight they woke up and they got really, really serious about it. I think they're trying to cover their butts.
Let's take.
Do you have a question?
Yeah. I don't know. I guess that, you know, I mean, there's a number of ways to approach it, but
don't feel obliged.
I think there is some question about what's how do you enforce any of this, and you can't be holding people accountable or pretending to care, right, or pretending to take these things seriously. So I think what's the right form for accountability to take, or how we determine when someone is taking issues seriously is something.
Before you move to, let's take another follow-up. Can we also have Julia's follow-up?
Yeah, my follow-up is quite naturally. I think echo that point a bit. I think this panel probably highlights a potential risk of the explainability debate, that it hides some of the politics and power asymmetries going on. But I think explainability is something that we can all sort of grapple with from, a position of impoverished information. And in some ways, it's helped the sort of inexorable momentum and the technological determinism of the digital colossi are going to be our mediators of media and health and credit potentially gets lost. I think that all of the speakers were sensitive to that. And I particularly wanted to pick up on Gilad's point. I was quite, your point about the context of an individual's network position, I was involved in a quite chilling set of conversations with the Digital News Initiative of Google and some British media organisations, where they were playing to the egos, I thought, of journalists and editors in saying, we really care about your work and we want to get various indicia that make sure that your stories, BBC and The Guardian, very credible stories, are ranked highly in our search results. And what I realised is that the tech companies don't care at all about publishers. They care about journalists, but they are interested in just disintermediating the publishers. And I think that that's why the power question is really important, because journalists have their power because they're part of a broader organisation, and I think occupy an essential position. Is there anything that sort of collectively can be done against this somehow, the atomization of journalists through metrics and so on that are there to support their algorithmic position?
So you want us to solve the issue with journalism?
I don't know. I mean, I think that some of the ways that journalists have, there are some moves that I think are going in a direction that's problematic, such as instant articles and so on, which mean that the publishers are themselves operating in somebody else's ecosystem with less power, and I think those are reversible.
I mean, that does assume, though, that we can go back to 1996 and the NewYorkTimes.com never happens, right? Like, I mean, instant articles is also dying. It's
that's not true.
I thought I just read that it wasn't really working and people are opting out of it.
Fake news.
Are we talking about hoaxes here or misinformation?
We got Donald Trump over here.
I'm joking. But it we use it.
Right.
We heavily use it. And I mean, it depends who you ask, I think.
Okay.
It's complicated. But I could try to tackle some of your questions and say I'm not, like, I think one thing that's really interesting for me about BuzzFeed is we're not weighed down by historical business models. So we can sort of try new things out. And it's not the story or the narrative isn't always about protecting publishing, but refiguring out publishing in this new era where we have hundreds of Facebook pages. We have Snapchat audiences, which are huge, 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 and super engaged. We have a ton of YouTube channels, right? Instagram is growing, and our own site. So we care about all these places. And I think being sort of figuring out ways to be innovative in a multi-publish or multi-platform world is key to surviving right now. And ways in which sort of reporters, media outlets can sort of have advantages with the multi-platform world, I think we'll sort of figure out ways to monetize and sort of run effective new kinds of businesses. But I think part of the issue is being weighed down by sort of older models. And so one thing that's come up with IA is with instant articles is, it's not getting as much engagement. It's not actually helping publishers, where it's true it's not driving as much traffic as potentially could be driven to the site, and then you're decreasing the number of potential subscribers, right, if that is your model. But if that is not your model, there's actually huge value in having your content up there, mm-hmm. From the scale of the audience, the reach, and from a growth perspective. So I think it really depends on what you're trying to do, what your goals are, and how you're effectively surviving as a business.
I think it is also worth noting, if I can say real quickly, some news organizations have been much better about this than others. A lot of news organizations have not been very strategic in this, and so I worked. And I was a reporter for 5 years, and I watched My editor and publisher at one of my daily newspapers, we were always 2 or 3 years behind what everybody else had already done. In 2007, they asked me to start a blog because blogs were going to be the next big thing. 2007, people were stopping blogging, right? So when news organizations are big and strategic and thinking about how these different parts can work, I think it's great. And I didn't mean to say anything earlier that would be counter to what Gilad just said. I just think there's a lot of concerns with the automation of some of the traditional journalism functions.
So we have 4 more questions and 5 more minutes. So I think we're going to take all 4 of them really quick, and hopefully we'll be able to address something.
I'm Lauren Hansen from Data Society. And I was wondering about explanation and transparency and manipulation in a bit of a different direction than I was talking about before. Or over the past few months, we've seen instances like Pizzagate, where there is, coming out of places like 4chan and 8chan, there is an organized section of the alt-right that has a very good understanding of journalistic processes and how to manipulate journalism using these algorithms and using the ways in which the hands of journalists are tied up with sources and fact-checking. Do you think with increasing transparency, there are ways to use that to also fortify journalism against this kind of grassroots manipulation, or that the more the transparency and the more explanation there is of the journalistic process, the easier it will be for actors to make the journalism for political ends?
So I just want to point out, I am a fan of pushing big, powerful, rich platforms like Google and Facebook to help out in reasonable and feasible ways. Google just rolled out Project Owl, right, which is the latest set of updates to its search algorithm. And one of the updates in the changelog is we're going to try to better prioritize authoritative content. And that sounds incredibly fraught to me, right, because they're not going to say what that means or how that functions. And I'm just curious about if part of solving the fake news, lumpy, terrible content problem is Google stepping in to help, and they have to do so substantively, what does transparency look like for that?
Okay.
So I want to go back to Brad made a comment about the worst of Facebook, and Gilad's response was, that's not typical. I think the real problem is that that's exactly right, that it's not typical. If there were 100% extremist nonsense on Facebook, people wouldn't pay attention to it. It's exactly because it's only a fraction of it that works. And to tie it back to the algorithm point, it's not at all clear to me that the most profitable spot for Facebook is 100% good stuff. It may well be that the sweet spot for profits is 90% good stuff, 10% extremist nonsense. And the algorithm, the capability might be enough to help them find that sweet spot, enough stuff to really disturb and attract people, but not to turn them off. And this applies to platforms in commercial contexts too, to like false reviews on Yelp and that sort of thing. It's a problematic situation.
I'm not expert in this field, but Julia's, I want to follow up a little bit on Julia's point, and maybe it echoes some other points, because it reminded me of some of what academic publishing has gone through, this kind of love-hate relationship with traditional publishers. So on the one hand, we were all celebrating the fact that, online and not this, stodgy peer review and the entrenched publishers, we're gonna get away from all of that. And I think that it sounds like in journalism, a similar kind of trend took place, and now having seen where we've gotten to, we're beginning archive the various archive publications where there's absolutely no peer review and nobody really has a sense of how to judge quality of the articles. That what Julia is saying, which I think is poignant, is that if Google is now trying to get rid of the intermediary, which is the entrenched publishers, let's say the New York Times, Washington Post, and list a bunch of them, then what they're doing then is they're saying the norms which cause articles or shaving cream or shoes to rise to the top are going to be our norms. When someone does a search on a topic, this is what's going to rise to the top, versus the norms that an experienced editor/publisher are going to say this article is newsworthy. This article holds public interest and deserves to be on the front page. And so I actually think that trend, you didn't respond to it, and I felt concerned that feels to me like a really important trend if indeed it is happening.
So I think I can. Yes. Okay. I can touch on that a little. While also, I didn't get your name.
Aaron.
Yeah. Aaron's point on authoritative sources or whatever it was being kind of fraught. So let's start with the fact that Frank's been very engaged in this conversation for over a decade. But the general thinking is search engines have a First Amendment right to prioritize what they want, that they are speakers to. And so I definitely think Google has every right to choose the authoritative sources. Of course, a newspaper has the right to choose the articles that go into the paper or that go on their homepage. But I agree that it is very fraught if it is framed, and I can only imagine, and this is, I mentioned, an algorithm that values trusted sources over non-trusted sources. The challenge is drawing that line. And I think we can look at a good example of this, or a good analog, is sort of the citizen journalism debate of a few years back, both in terms of First Amendment rights. Is there a special press right? Generally thought to be also not. But if there was, does it also apply to citizen journalists? And secondarily, in many states, there are shield laws that prevent reporters from having to disclose their sources, but they don't apply to those who aren't professional journalists. And what the question is, what's a professional journalist? How do you draw that line? So how, it has not been answered well, and so I don't know that you can say that, what is an authoritative source? Does it have to be legacy media? It shouldn't, right? Is BuzzFeed an authoritative source? I think certainly. Would I have said that 5 years ago? Probably not, no offense. But they do really, really good work. Well, so when does the light switch flip? Like when does Google decide this is now an authoritative source? Again, they have a First Amendment right to do that, but I don't know that it's going to help.
So this is actually one of the areas where journalists have been stepping up and looking and trying to benchmark actually what types of sources are popping up in Google when you search for Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton, and describing and kind of creating that transparency information. If the companies aren't going to do it themselves, then perhaps third parties need to step in, collect data about what types of sources are surfacing on these platforms, and then communicating that back to the public to say, well, and actually this is what we found in the last election. The New York Times and CNN dominated 45% of the in the news links when you searched for their names. So why do those two sources capture close to half of the news attention at the top of the search? I don't know. I couldn't tell you that. Maybe Google should open up and explain a little bit more about that. But at least we can start to describe that and observe that as a phenomenon.
So I'd like to thank our panelists. And if you'd like to continue the discussion, you can do so over coffee.